Samaras. Thank you for your answer. Get my wireless mic. Oh, I need it or not, but I'll give it a try. Okay, everybody hear me all right? Great. I guess it's still morning, isn't it? Not before noon. Well, good morning. It's a pleasure to be here. I've actually chased through Tennessee before. I have to say, I don't like it much because there's too many trees. I can't see too many hills. I love the high plains chasing out in Colorado, Kansas, western Oklahoma, Iowa, and of course I absolutely love South Dakota. One of the reasons that propels me, and the reason I'm driven so much to understand these monsters, is because they're one of the final frontiers. Tornadoes are one of the final frontiers of trying to figure out how powerful these things are. And the super outbreak is one of those cases where the atmosphere has just gone mad, absolutely mad. 336 tornadoes over a three-day period. It happens to be one of the biggest tornado outbreaks in recent history. And for us to understand why the atmosphere creates these things and creates such violence, you have to get in, you have to get up close and personal to help study and improve our understanding of thunderstorms and tornadoes. And for us to do that, you have to get instruments in and near the path of the tornado. Computation model data is great. That's going to be the ultimate future. But for us to validate those models, guess what we have to do? You have to collect the actual data to see if the models are on or right. It's the only way you're going to do it. Model data is great, but they're only as great as the data that you give it. If you give crappy data, guess what? You're going to have a crappy computer model forecast. So for us to understand these things and the damage they do, such as the Tuscaloosa damage, we have to get up close and personal. A lot of scientists these days are doing just that. Dr. Bustein, Dr. Werman, myself, Texas Tech, they all have specific programs to get up close and personal. And you know, Reed and Chris and Joel are also collecting some valuable data right next to tornadoes. And I must say, I admire the TVN team. They do incredible work out there. Reed and Chris and Joel, they got a determination like I've never seen before. It's incredible. One of the biggest mysteries is knowing how powerful the tornado winds are. And how powerful the tornado winds are near the surface of the ground. Near the surface of the ground is where all the damage is being done. And this is the measurement that's the most difficult to get. Obviously, it's very, very difficult to look near ground wind speeds of tornadoes. Above ground, several hundred feet, up to several thousand feet, we have terabytes of data. Mobile Doppler radar has collected an incredible amount of data, what's happening way up there in the thunderstorm. Dr. Werman, Dr. Bustein, and others have collected a lot of data. What we want to do is to be able to take that data that's collected in the upper atmosphere and compare it to what's happening down on the ground. If we knew the relationship between the wind speeds up in the air and down on the ground, the mobile Doppler radar, if they're measuring 250 mile an hour winds in the upper atmosphere, and we had a good idea of the wind speed comparisons near the ground, and say it's 200, then we can understand that relationship better. We understand, you know, how powerful the winds are near the ground. That can create this kind of damage. That's what at least one of the groups, my group, is trying to assess. TWISTEX, Tactical Weather Sampling and Tornadoes Thunderstorm Experiment. Basically what we do, we take instrumentation and surround the entire thunderstorm complex. This is a what they call an old mezzanine. I'll be talking a little bit about this. But we have several vehicles that are outfitted with this type of instrumentation. We surround the entire thunderstorm. We want to understand the type of air that's getting drawn into the thunderstorm. If we understood the type of air that's getting drawn into the thunderstorm and understand all the other processes, our forecasts for tornadoes and these types of thunderstorms have become better. So that's really the big purpose. And also, of course, a lot of the work that I've been doing over the past 10 years is sampling tornado cores directly. I have to tell you, for the younger folks in the crowd here, when I first started doing this, sampling tornadoes on the inside, had a lot of people tell me it couldn't be done. You know, everybody's familiar with NSSL's Toto. Back in the 80s, Dr. Bluestein, NSSL, they tried for 6 years trying to get that device in the tornado. It was just too big, too clumsy. The information network wasn't out there, you know, to really help track tornadoes. Their success rates were pretty poor. So that instrument basically is sitting in a museum. I believe it's sitting in the National Weather Center, if I'm not mistaken. And there's been a movie, of course, surrounding that, and I think they call it Dorothy now. Bill Haxton and Helen Hunt and all that. So, of course, when I came around and wanted to measure the tornado directly, a lot of people tell me, especially the veterans that tried this measurement themselves. And I won't mention any names, but he sat in the audience in a talk I gave in Boulder, Colorado. After I talked about this instrument called the HIPPER, Hard In-Situ Tornado Pressure Recorder, this gentleman, who I held in high regard, raised his hand and says, "Mr. Samaras, I hate to tell you this, but your chances of getting this in a tornado are very slim. You're better off, you know, figuring out another way to measure tornadoes. You know, you can use radar, you can use other devices, but that's not going to happen. You will fail." I think I listened to him. No way. I had a determination of doing this measurement. I designed and built this instrument specifically to measure the pressure drop inside of the tornado. Quarter-inch steel, has a small microcomputer on the inside, measures pressure drop, measures the pressure differences along the surface, and actually calculates the true static pressure in a tornado. Because measuring the pressure in a very strong wind field is very, very difficult. You put a pressure gauge out there in free space and you've got wind blowing across the top of it. The fact that the wind is blowing across the pressure gauge face itself will change the pressure measurements because you've got the actual pressure of the wind itself making the pressure different. And so we had to devise a system to make true static pressure measurements in a very high wind environment. And that's what this device does. I built this back in 2001. It's a long time. 13 years ago, and almost every year I've been able to collect measurements inside of tornadoes, including the 100 millibar pressure drop in Manchester, South Dakota. The instrument on the bottom center actually has 7 video cameras on the inside. In fact, I think I saw a video the National Weather Service folks played. That was pretty cool. I was actually walking and says, "Dude, that's my video." Of course, the idea of that is that we can actually look on the inside the tornado using a practice called photogrammetry. We can actually calculate to some degree how fast the wind speeds are moving inside the tornado near the ground. That's where my interest is, how powerful the winds are near the surface of the ground. And using video and some known measurements to do your calculation, we found that wind speeds were over 100 miles an hour, only 6 inches above the ground. Stop and think about that for a minute. That's a lot. I mean, that's incredible. Of course, there's a couple of scientists in the back room telling me, just shaking their head. They were total disbelief. They were looking at the model, the standard vortex model, saying, that's near impossible. Well, it's not impossible because we measured it. Again, it's another reason why we're in the field trying to collect these measurements. And collecting these measurements have always been a challenge. And the problem is with, trying to measure the wind speed in a tornado is that your anemometer sort of comes apart in the tornado. I mean, it's the traditional ones. I know Reed has had a couple of anemometers blown apart when he's driven the denominator inside of a tornado before it. But the problem is the propeller, mechanical motions, it all comes apart. It's by debris impact and so forth. And so I designed and conceived the design of a new type of anemometer using a pedostatic tube. Anybody familiar with pedostatic tube? Okay, I see a few hands. Basically what that instrument is, it measures the airspeed of aircraft. It's been around for a long time. It's a proven method, but nobody is crazy enough to take a pedostatic tube and put it on a rocket ship looking device and go stick it in the tornado. That is my plan here. Because pedostatic tube doesn't have any moving parts, and it can accurately measure the wind speed up to close to sonic. And it actually can go beyond sonic if you apply a slightly different calculation. And I also designed a way to ensure that the instrument is pointed directly in the wind. Because if the pedostatic tube is not pointed directly in the wind, your measurements become invalid. And although it's simply good to know, because you can take that data and throw it out. This device that I designed, that Hyperion helped me build, does exactly that. Tells me whether or not the device is accurately pointed in the wind by making different pressure measurements along the static core. But this is the type of thing that I do. I love designing and building new instruments that tackle very, very difficult problems. This is another instrument that's well known. It's actually used in the first Vortex project back in the mid-90s, called the Mobile Mesonet System. It measures wind speed, direction, temperature, pressure, humidity, all while moving down the road. In fact, the wind speed and direction, we've written some software code that's on our computer. You'd be flying down the interstate at 75 miles an hour, and I can tell you the wind is out of the southeast of 10 knots. Basically, it subtracts out the vector of the wind speed by knowing the speed of your vehicle. Using GPS tracking, you can actually subtract out the actual direction. So it allows us to know what the wind speed is doing, whether the vehicle is moving or not. And, of course, having these things on top of your vehicle scares the daylights out of local folks when you drive through their town. In fact, I've had several occasions where I'll drive up and I had some old boy come up and says, "You're not invited to this town. Turn around and leave." As if I brought the severe weather with me. I says, "No, sir, we're out making measurements. It's okay. We're not bringing it with us. We're not going to open the trunk and let it out. It's okay. It's cool. You know, we're trying to push the advancement of our understanding here of why these things create so much devastation." So we have about three or four of these vehicles out there, and we've got them strapped to the roof, and those are the instruments we use to surround the thunderstorm. We generally deploy a few to the south, a few to the north, a few to the east, and if you have any left over, we try to get out to the west and rear flank down to that portion and map it. We data log it, and then afterwards we take the whole picture. We take all of the data, we plot it down on a map, and we plot it, and so we can understand the ingestion of the type of air quality that's going into the thunderstorm complex itself. The latest toy that we used a couple of years ago was an X-band radar system. This actually turned out to be a real boon for TWISTEX. TWISTEX normally cannot afford a radar, you know, at $700,000 a piece. It's just inconceivable for us to have one. The fine folks at EWR loaned us one of these instruments. They actually trusted me with one of their instruments. Of course, I had to be overly protective, if you may recall on the television show. A lot of dude says, "Oh, Samaras is too chicken going to the store." Well, it's sort of partially true in some respects. In others, not so much. In fact, the owner of the company says, "I don't care if you smash your radome. Just go in there. I don't care. You know, we'll replace it. Radomes are cheap." But still, liability of having a $700,000 radar in the back made me a little skirmish. I don't know. But because of that, because of the time and the funding and everything, obviously the thing to do is to put this radar on a separate vehicle. Given the time and the timing of the funding and so forth, just couldn't get it done. So I had to put it on the TWISTEX Pro vehicle, and of course the show did a great job of telling you what I did wrong. And of course, here's all the fleet of the vehicles. We don't drive big Hummers or big military vehicles, we drive Chevy Cobalts. They're cheap to fix, they're cheap on gas, and you can get parts everywhere. You can walk in any auto parts store and get our starter for it. I love them. The old probe vehicle has been replaced by this thing that I built for the show. It's a one-ton truck. You can see the radar, the mobile mesonet, and of course the new probe instrument that's on the back that we actually we wound up deploying a similar model in the battle tornado, which I'm going to show you some of the data from. One of our, a lot of our core missions is to actually collect data from tornadoes, of course, in their tornado environments, the environment that's surrounding the supercell. Understand tornado genesis and decay. Why do tornadoes appear to go on and on and on in some cases, and then other tornadoes, they're over in 30 seconds and never going to be seen? What creates a supercell thunderstorm becomes cyclic and produce tornado after tornado after tornado for several hours? These are some of the things we're trying to answer. Of course, boundaries. Boundaries are something that we always target because it seems like boundaries, whether they're a temperature boundary or wind shift from a collapsed thunderstorm, seem to provoke tornadoes. We're always looking for boundaries in the morning on visible satellite, and we're targeting those boundaries depending on their orientation, and because they'll provide that extra little turning of the winds, and I'm sure you'll probably be learning a little bit more about that in the spotter class this afternoon. They provide a little extra turning of the winds to help promote tornado production. In fact, I've seen many cases where a supercell storm will develop and won't produce a tornado until it crosses the boundary. Once it crosses the boundary, it produces a tornado that may last 10 to 20 minutes. Once it crosses the boundary, it's done. I mean, it'll sit there and spit out annoying hail and lots of rain and a bunch of lightning, but it won't ever produce a tornado again. It's only when it crosses the boundary. And we want to understand that process, too. What kinds of stuff do we want to know? Now, one of the big data sets we collected was from the big Bowdell tornado on May 22nd, 2010. And I think Discovery showed a lot of our footage on there, but despite my hampering, I wanted them to talk a little bit about the data that we collected. Nobody heard about the data, right? They saw, look at Samaras and Carl and Reed and Joel, everybody get right in there with the tornado, but they never really talked about what data we collected. Well, today I'm going to talk a little bit about what we had actually collected. This is the path of the Bowdell tornado, and we actually went back and surveyed this tornado, and we have good reason to believe this tornado should have been rated EF5. We talked to the National Weather Service at Aberdeen about that. He says, yeah, I'm right on the edge, but he says, politically, if we mention EF5, that seems to attract a lot of attention, and it only hit a couple of farmhouses, and yeah. But we saw one of the big drivers for me as far as an EF5, it actually hit a power line, the distribution line, those great big tower things, about 80, 90 feet high. In fact, you'll see it in the video. Sucked it down, crumpled it up in a ball, and tossed it 600 feet. That is a lot of power because these things weigh several thousand pounds. In fact, it happened. It happened just right up on the road there where it was mentioned that where the EF4, there's two dots over there in the top right. That's where those power lines were. Now, one of the things that I'm trying to measure is how quickly the wind speeds accelerate from the ground up to maybe 10, 20 feet. It's got the, the ground boundary there. I want to know how quickly they accelerate. Yeah, everybody knows that, maximum wind speed. Dr. Gorman measured one pixel of the radar data during the May 3rd, 1999 tornado outbreak of 318 miles an hour. But that was several hundred feet in the air. How quickly does the wind speed build from the ground up? That's what I would like to know. If we knew this kind of data, and knew how the chaotic wind patterns are near the surface, then perhaps we could take that data and say, here, Mr. Structure Engineer, try to find some good, effective ways to better build this house so it survive an average tornado, maybe save a few lives. That's the objective, is to understand the wind field. And so I set out to build a device that measured the wind speed at three different heights, 0.7 meters, 1.2, and a 2 meter height. The idea is we get those three data points as the tornado goes over, then maybe we can understand how quickly the winds are accelerating. In the case of the Ballard tornado, we were lucky to get this monster instrument in the path of the tornado. And the beginning stages of it basically just passed over the top of it. And what we found was actually quite interesting. And the measurements we actually, the device we use is basically called a sonic anemometer. Basically, a sonic anemometer measures the speed of sound. And in a windstorm, the speed of sound changes, depending if the wind's going with the sound or against the sound. They actually measure the time delay between the transmitter and receiver, and they do it in four spots. You get three-dimensional flow plus wind speed. So it's actually quite clever. But unfortunately, when you have debris flowing through it, such as a tornado, it actually skews the data a little bit, creates noise spikes, like what you see here. So basically what we do is we filter out those noise spikes to ensure that we have got consistent data. And so here's the graph, time versus speed, of the 2 meter wind speed and the 0.75 meter wind speed that we collected on this instrument. Now this is in meters per second, which 50 meters per second is roughly 100 miles per hour or so. And so the top one is 2 meters, the bottom one is 0.75 meters. And what we found, it was the same. The wind speeds at 0.75, which is about 2 feet, were exactly the same as they were a little over 6 feet, which tells me that the ground boundary layer, the greatest rate of change, is under 2 feet. Stop and think about that for a little bit. That's pretty incredible. In fact, I have reason to believe, based on some of my other measurements, that suggests the greatest rate of change probably happens within 6 inches above the ground. Pretty weird. I mean, this is data that has never been sampled, never been measured before. So it actually raised the eye to the structural engineer who's trying to build a house and figure out what's the best way, what's the best route to do, what can we do to help protect ourselves from these strong winds. How many of you thought I was just going to talk about tornadoes? All right, so everybody knows I play with lightning too. Okay, that's good. First, some lightning basics. As we all know, lightning basically starts from the sky, as known as the step leader. It's basically an electrical charge that comes down from the thunderstorm. And the bottom left panel, you can see from that little animated tree, there's what they call a dart leader, positively charged dart leader comes up. The bottom center panel, they actually connect. The time delta here between the top right and the bottom center is approximately anywhere between 5 to 10 milliseconds. That's like a couple thousandths of a second. Blink of an eye. That's why you go out and watch and observe lightning. How many of you like to go out and watch a lightning storm? Yeah, me too. That's why you don't ever see this, because it happens so fast. Now, the bottom right panel, that's the return stroke. That's the flash we see and the bang we hear from thunder. That bad boy travels from the ground to the cloud at 0.5 the speed of light. Very, very fast. So my problem is, and I started looking at this lightning, gosh, I think back in 2005, 2006, and I go on the internet and I wanted to see actual photographs of how lightning is formed, and all I got was cartoons. This is, nobody's done this before. There's been a few isolated cases where they use what they call a street camera to capture lightning, but nothing really shows you the actual formation. Well, my background happens to be in high-speed photography. I've done high-speed photography for over 30 years. How many of you are familiar with high-speed photography? There's a few. Basically, high-speed photography is something that you watch almost every time you put on a sporting event. Football, baseball, what have you. I'll give you an example. You're watching a football game, quarterback throws a pass out to the wide receiver, he's at the end zone, he reaches up there and tries to capture it. Ball sails over his hands, drops the ball. You know, you're thinking,
Dude, what happened? How come he dropped the ball? Well, what happens next? Your announcer shows it in slow motion, right? Slow it down, you can see the receiver moving in slow motion. He's up there trying to catch the ball. And clearly you can see the ball sailing right over the finger. You're screaming at the television. Dude, all you need to do is drop another 6 to 12 inches. You could have the winning score and touchdown. Would have gotten it. But they used high-speed photography. Your normal video camera runs at 30 frames per second. A high-speed camera for a sporting event will run 120 frames per second. So it's captured more frames per second. And then slows it down so you can see what's going on. Basically, sort of capturing time. More and higher resolution steps. And I looked for high-speed photography of lightning. I couldn't find it. It didn't exist. Simply because technology wasn't there to support it. So, being that my background was in high-speed photography, sometimes it takes just knowing what to do, knowing that there's a technology like these fan cameras out there, and knowing it, taking it out, putting some additional instrumentation to it, and using this instrument to capture a lightning strike. In this case, these cameras, can capture a lightning strike at 10 to 15,000 frames per second, which is about the speed that you need to look at the step reader process. You know, this camera weighs about 15 pounds. They're very expensive, and they're easy to use. I adapted a photo detector on there, watching for flash and so forth, and they're all digital. For those of you who don't know, I built a device called the Kahuna. The Kahuna is an ultra-high-speed camera capable of 1.4 million frames per second. This bad boy is hoped to capture the first ever shot of the return stroke being developed as that lightning bolt hits, just touches the ground, and the return stroke goes back up. Remember the speed I was telling you? 0.5 speed of light. Well, you need a camera going at a million frames per second to see it. And so this has been a project that I've been working on for the past several years. And because it's being so difficult to get, because you're trying to point a camera to an area that you think a lightning strike's going to hit, and you only have 30 seconds because this camera runs on helium. It spins up a turbine up to close to 4,000 revolutions per second. And you can only run the camera for about a half a minute before the turbine explodes because it gets so hot. So I got a 30-second window. I turn it on, and I hope the heck that lightning strike happens in front of the camera. It's tough because you have to pick the right storm. You have to look maybe like in front of the rain foot of a very repeatable lightning. Minute or so. And having all those combinations come together has been very difficult. And so we're still out looking for that first shot. And of course this camera is quite large. It weighs 1,500 pounds. And I actually converted. There's in the top right picture shows the camera in its original form. This is a Cold War era camera. It uses 35 millimeter film. It was actually used to photograph a nuclear detonation in the Nevada test site or in the South Pacific. This is what these cameras were used for. And of course, in its formal life as well, I used it when I was at the University of Denver to photograph conventional explosives, watching an 8-pound bomb go off and seeing it in slow motion at 500,000 frames per second. So I'm a pretty good veteran at this camera. In fact, there's a story that goes with this camera. Because since I left the university in 1996, I went off and did my own thing, the camera remained. I was the only person who had around the camera. So when I left, the camera gathered a lot of dust, sat in the back lab, totally unused. Well, I think about 2005, I get a phone call from my old buddy down there, still at the university. He says, "Hey, Tim, you're getting rid of this camera. You want it?" I says, "Absolutely." So I told my wife that I was going to bid on, because it was a government camera, so they put it up on a government sale and all that stuff. So I told my wife, "Looks like I want a camera, I'll be right back." She didn't understand that it weighed 1,600 pounds. And of course, when I brought it home in a state bed truck, she didn't let me in the house with it. I had to go rent a storage space and put it in there for a year. But I bought it for the specific purpose of trying to capture this lightning strike. Of course, then National Geographic had supported the conversion all to all digital using some 11 megapixel sensors. And since I've done this work, it has now become the highest speed, highest resolution camera in the world. In fact, during the Chaser Car Show, I was lucky enough to actually bring the camera down here. It's here in the parking lot. So during the car show, I'd be happy to show those who are interested this particular camera. Also, for those of you who are National Geographic subscribers, this camera and the story is featured in this month's August 2012 National Geographic magazine as well. It's on the newsstands, I think it is now, although I have not got my copy yet. So the idea was that we bring the camera to the field. And of course, weighing 1,600 pounds, in the past we've used a trailer to put the camera in there. We'd drop down the back gate and we'd try to photograph the lightning strike. That became a little cumbersome because there was a lot of things we'd do. Of course, in a highly electrified environment, that means we put ourselves at risk, you know, out trying to get any access to the trailer and so forth. And what we target the monsoon storm and storms in Colorado, New Mexico, and Arizona from the August through July, August, and September time frame. And monsoon basically means the air mass is basically reverse flow. There's a lot of moisture that resides in there. And these thunderstorms move really slow, like 5 knots or less. Contrary to what Chris and I chase, you know, when we're chasing tornadoes, we want a big, strong upper flow. We want those thunderstorms to get energized, like how you listened this morning. The upper winds actually rejuvenates and creates these powerful storms. We want air mass, what we call air mass thunderstorms, just enough shear in the atmosphere to get these things really going, and a lot of convection take place, a lot of lightning. And these things move slow. I could sit out there most of the afternoon and photograph one thunderstorm. They move so slow. And those are my perfect type, that's the perfect type of thunderstorm for me to go out and photograph this camera. I don't like driving all over the place. But even with the trailer, it got to be a bit of a hassle. So many of you who have been following some of my rare Facebook posts, and I unfortunately don't have a lot of time to be posting on Facebook, but I do occasionally. I managed to get some funding from DARPA to actually put this camera in a 17-foot box truck. In fact, it's on its way to Tupelo with Hyperion to put an optical periscope on it, because that camera basically is going to shoot up through the roof, and it's going to rotate the mirror so I can point that camera 360 degrees. That was the problem I had with the trailer. You know, I back up the trailer, I drop the door. The only way I can point is where the back end of the trailer is pointing. Well, it's a pain in the butt. Oh, Tim, look, thunderstorm over there. Well, I've got to get in there and move the truck around and back up the trailer. What a pain. So, okay, I approached DARPA with this idea. They loved it. They are actually an ongoing and a huge research initiative to study the physics about lightning. And DARPA stands for Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency. And I know what you're thinking. You're thinking these guys are building a ray gun out of lightning, aren't you? I have to dispel that truth right now. Truth, did I say that? I dispel that right now. It's not going to happen. They are interested in studying the physics of lightning because right now they were uncomfortable with the current state of knowledge about lightning. They want to know how lightning originates in a thunderstorm, as an example. How does that electrical charge build up and actually create this electrical, this lightning strike? They also want to know how these upper atmospheric discharges happen. Have you heard of sprites? Any of you heard about sprites? A few hands. There's actually a luminescence discharge called a sprite that happens 20 to 30 miles above the thunderstorm. That happens on some very energetic lightning strikes, namely from positive strikes. And when these happen, they create these incredible lights or energy discharge way above the thunderstorm. What we're trying to do is understand the entire electrification process from the sprite being generated from the very, very top, 30 miles up in the sky, all the way down to the ground. So part of the mission of this camera and this new instrument is to try to bring some better knowledge to, you know, how a lightning strike is formed, how it all ties together. The ultimate result is that if we knew more about the physics of lightning, then perhaps our troops in the field could be better protected by taking a few simple measures as they are deployed in Afghanistan and so forth. And they do get some incredible thunderstorms in Afghanistan. Okay.
Oh, fantastic.
Now on to some video. Normal lightning strike taken with a standard 30 frames per second camera looks like this. Yeah, it's kind of cool. Unfortunately, there isn't enough information there to really identify and see what's going on. Even if you take that standard video camera and slow it down, you can't capture the step leader process adequately to see and measure how that lightning strike is formed and moves through the atmosphere. Again, you have to have the right technology to meet the challenges. And in this case, it's a camera running at 10,000 frames per second. So now, with the camera running 10,000 frames per second, we can slow down time and look at the lightning strike being formed from the top of the thunderstorm and reaching all the way down to the ground. And they're kind of like snowflakes. No two lightning strikes are alike. I've shown this video at several conferences and I still love to watch it. They say a picture is worth a thousand words. When you see an image like this, all of a sudden you can instantly understand a lot of the physics of lightning. As an example, although the lightning is branching out, it looks like, you know, the first one that hits the ground will get the discharge, and when it does, all the other branches seem to fade away. That's what some of this technology helps us do. It turns very difficult problems into easy problems to understand. And of course, then again, it also invokes a lot of questions, and that's how the scientific process sometimes works, is when you think you've discovered something, you'll find out that it'll actually generate more questions than it does answers. Get an idea, the top of that semi is actually driving down the road at 70 miles an hour, but at that framing rate, it looks like it's sitting still. Of course, they're great pictures, but they also have a scientific purpose, because you know the framing rate, and you also perhaps know a unit of measure along the ground. In this case, a power pole that's roughly 10, 12 meters high, you can actually calculate the velocity of the step leader approaching the ground. You can average over several frames, you go frame to frame, and see whether or not the step leader is accelerating or decelerating as it reaches the ground. And in very rare cases, you can actually see where the return stroke just begins to form. This is the part here. This frame right here is what I'm trying to capture with the kahuna, the million frame per second camera. And of course, the very next frame looks like Armageddon, because the exposure I've set for the camera is set to capture the step leader, not the return stroke. Return stroke is approximately two orders of magnitude brighter than the step leader, so it gets all blinded. Now, National Geographic photographer Karsten Peter is the photographer responsible for both the tornado article in April 2004 National Geographic magazine, and also the brand new issue, August 2012 Geographic magazine. And I think he got a little jealous because that's Karsten's profile in the shot. So he had to get in one of the shots. I don't know why he's standing there. He's crazy. He's probably one of the best photographers in the world. You know, you've seen his work in the caves in Vietnam, glaciers, he jumps in volcanoes, chases tornadoes and lightning with me. He's absolutely crazy, but he's also brilliant at the same time. Sometimes I question the brilliant part. He's from Germany, right? And During one of the lightning episodes, I mean, lightning was going crazy. I mean, we were getting 3 to 5 flashes a second, highly electrified environment, my electric e-field meter was just going crazy. Where's Carson? He's up on a hill with a metal tripod taking pictures of my trail. I says, Carson, get your butt inside, man. This is not a good place. Oh, Tim, don't worry about it. I'll be fine. He pulled that stuff with me several times until one time in Kansas, we were actually tornado chasing, and we're in the field, and lightning getting close, man. We were at a development walk cloud. We thought this thing was going to produce. And where's Carson? He's out there doing his normal stunt with the camera, and trying to get pictures of the light. I says, Carson, the lightning is getting too close. Get yourself inside. Oh, you know, the standard is, oh, Tim, don't worry about it. Then it happened. Had a lightning strike 100 feet away. Have any of you had a lightning strike happen really close to them? You know what it's like. Flashbang happened all of a sudden. Sounds like an explosion. The big plume of dust comes up. And next thing I know, Carson jumped so high that he started running before he hit the ground. And his eyes got this, of course he struggles with English. His eyes are this big. He says, Tim, I almost got electrified. I says, yeah, you almost got electrified. Next time maybe you'll listen. Don't be out there, you crazy maniac. But that's Carson. You know, and you have to take risks in order to get those incredible shots with the society. He tells me all the time that he's up there on a mountaintop, he's taking pictures, and he's got this $1,500 lens. You know, he's an Nikon fan, he's got this $1,500 lens on the front of his camera. You know, he's changing lenses, and once in a while the lenses slip out, and it just bounces down the hill about 1,400 feet. Yeah, well, let's go buy another one. I says, okay, Carson, whatever. Anyway, to finish this up, of course, then after the return stroke ensues, then the channel cools, and sometimes you can actually see where you get 3, 4, or 6 times the strike and follow the same path. And that's because the path that's already been generated by the first strike remains to be highly more conductive than the surrounding areas. This is a black and white shot. I collected 15,000 frames per second. That shows some incredible detail. At 15,000 frames per second, you can actually see the very beginning of the step meter flicker. It was like a stroke effect. And remember the part I was saying that sometimes it invokes more questions than answers? Well, that's something we never really saw before. And so there are several people that actually taken off and are studying the phenomenon of that flickering end of the step meter. Triggered lightning. Last summer I had a chance to go to Langmuir Laboratory to look at, measure, and photograph triggered lightning. For those of you who don't know triggered lightning, what triggered lightning is, it's basically these guys, you know, these are college kids up here. They're having the best time of their lives. They're taking model rockets, putting a copper wire end in it, firing these model rockets into the thunderstorm with trailing copper wire so they can direct the lightning strike down to the point of impact. I mean, how cool is that? And these kids go up there all summer. In fact, they're up there now doing this work. Of course, this gives you the advantage of knowing where the lightning strike's going to hit. So, you know, the idea was that you knew where the camera hit, where to aim the camera. And so we brought the trailer, everything up there. This is about 11,000 feet. Beautiful area. This is out in west central New Mexico. Almost a lightning capital of the world, although Florida has that title. And so we sat up and tried to capture triggered lightning. And this is the instrument. This is what they call Kiva, 10,000 feet. This is where they launch these rockets. The rockets on the right-hand side, basically it's two metallic-type arrows with a Estes G engine on the bottom. These are the model rocket engine. They fire these things up. They go several hundred feet in the air. And that little bottom thing there on the bottom is the copper and Kevlar wire that they shoot up. It's pretty cool stuff. And so we went up there and tried to do a shot running the camera. It's kind of uneventful when you
see it in real time, but if you slow it down, this is what you see. This camera was running about 10,000 frames per second. You can clearly see that little straight arrow is where they launched the rocket, so it was a straight of a straight arrow, but this process is far different than your naturally produced lightning strike, because naturally produced lightning strike, the energy gets discharged, you know, right at the end. Here, when it's induced, I don't think there is as much energy being discharged. In fact, it's really hard to tell because it's kind of bright in here, but this thing, the movie's still running. What surprises me, you would think that after the discharge, you would think there's no energy left in the thunderstorm. This camera is still running. You can still see the glow of the vaporized copper wire. And right at the end, we're all surprised by this. Where did that charge come from? I have no idea. This was just amazing. But that was actually really quite an incredible experience. I hope to return up there someday, because this allows us to be able to look up close and personal to a lightning strike and know exactly where it hits. But of course, my first love is the naturally produced. That's where the most energy gets dumped, shortest amount of time. That's initial hit. I'm probably running over a little bit here. I do have a 20-minute video. Do I have time for that? Okay. You guys want to see a video? Okay. Give me just a minute here. I'm going to get rid of that. I don't need to adjust my display anymore. My son put this video together. You know, he assembled all kinds of music and so forth, and it's just kind of a snapshot of some of the trainers I've seen over the years. Okay. All right, I'm going to go and enter full screen. And move this little wonder bar down here. And we hit play. First one is probably by far the most photogenic tornado I've ever seen. Did was destroy a bunch of hay bales, as you see.
Listen to it.
course, this is the Manchester tornado. This is where we collected the 100 millibar pressure drop from. This tornado was rated F4. That was before the enhanced computer scale. This tornado grew to about a quarter mile wide. In fact, I'm not sure if this video shows it. There's a certain somebody down there that's down the end of this road. His name is Reed Timmer. He's getting yet another up close and personal look there.
You put down?
Yeah.
For the camera?
Actually. Yeah. I hope it's on the ground.
I'll be lucky to find it.
This was my first big hit of a strong tornado my probe was. On the ground.
Yes.
But the gravel was still here. Still underneath it. All the rest of the gravel has been scoured out. I wasn't around the road, straight past over the top, but scoured out all the gravel.
We think left
the instrument.
Thank you. moving Newtown.
Beautiful! My God, that's a beautiful tornado.
Yes, he's very vocal. Yes!
perfect. Here's another case where not many people thought a tornado was possible because of the weak upper level winds.
It's getting there.
Wow! We took a chance. In fact,
gorgeous.
We didn't have a Discovery camera crew with us. It was just Carl and I. This is the camp of tornado. In fact, Andy Gabrielson and I drag raced to this tornado.
Wow. Amazing. Wow. Wow. That's amazing. I can't believe it.
What's the gear value? 20 knots here?
I know. Hey, you want to grab my camera out and take some coming pictures of mine?
Thank you.
can see the hazards of why you don't want to chase in the trees. It makes spotting and chasing extremely dangerous. This is a video from Tony's camera, believe it or not, that when they were behind us. And here's another reason why you don't want to chase the trees. You don't know where the tornado's crossing. Fortunately, we stopped a couple hundred feet before the tornado crossed the road in front of us. It was literally a couple hundred feet. Of course, some of the damage left. This is a Tuscaloosa, I believe. Just incredible. You can tell how violent the tornado is when you see these horizontal vortex stream off of it. That means that you've got a lot of vertical flow in and near the tornado. And this designates, you know, a pretty violent tornado when you see this type of thing happen.
think that's the end of the presentation. I will have some, I have a book available. I have a brand new DVD that actually today is the first release. It's Driven by Passion 2, and the last one I released was back in 2005. So I don't put DVDs out. That's not my main focus of business, but we did manage to put one together. I should say my son did. And for the first time ever, it's available in the back room. Thank you very much.